Well, good afternoon, everybody, family and friends. We are gathered here today to, yes, praise God, but also to celebrate the life, the great life of Fred Jean Ray. And so we come together in grief, acknowledging our loss, our human loss. And so may God grant us grace that in pain we may find comfort, in sorrow, hope, and in death, resurrection. Now hear these words. Dying Christ destroyed our death, rising Christ restored our life, and Christ, as we know, will come again in glory. As in baptism Fred put on Christ, so in Christ may Fred be clothed with glory. Here and now, dear friends, we are all God's children, and what we shall be has not yet been revealed, but we know that when he appears, we shall be like him. Those who have this hope purify themselves as Christ is pure. Now Jesus said, I am the resurrection and I am life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet shall they live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I died, and behold, I am alive evermore, and I hold the keys of hell and death. Hear the good news, because I live, you shall live also. Let us pray. Eternal God, we praise you for the great company of all those who have finished their course in faith and now rest from their labor. We praise you for those dear to us whom we name in our hearts before you. And especially, Father, we praise you for Fred Ray, whom you have graciously received into your presence. And to all of these, grant your peace. Let perpetual light shine upon them and help us so to believe where we have not seen, that your presence may lead us through our years and bring us at last with them into the joy of your home, not made with hands, but eternal in the heavens, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. At this time, I would like to invite you to sing with us as we sing our hymn of praise, and it's going to be in your hymnal, in hymn number 77, How Great Thou Art.
Stars, I hear the rolling thunder, and power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art! How great thou art! Then sings my soul. Sing sweetly in the trees. When I look down from lofty mountain grandeur and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art! How great thou art! Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art! How great thou art! And when I think that God his Son not sparing sent him to die, I scarce can take it in, that on the cross my burden gladly bearing he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to how great thou art! How great thou art! Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art! How great thou art! When Christ shall come with a shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art! my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art.
At this time, we're going to join in together as one of our traditions in the United Methodist Church and say together the Apostles' Creed. You can find that in the back of your hymnal. It's number 881, the traditional version. And I invite you to join in with me. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Our next hymn of praise is going to be hymn number 504, The Old Rugged Cross.
On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross, where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Oh, that old rugged cross, so despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it to dark Calvary. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. In that old rugged cross, stained with blood so divine, a wondrous beauty I see. For 'twas on that old cross Jesus suffered and died to pardon and to sanctify me. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. To the old rugged cross I will ever be true. Its shame and reproach gladly bear. Then he'll call me someday to my home far away, where his glory forever I'll share. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown.
Rather, from two passages of Scripture. First, I'd like to read to you from the book of Ecclesiastes. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 1 through 8. For everything there's a season, and a time for every matter under heaven, a time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant, a time to pluck up what is planted, a time to kill, a time to be healed, a time to break down, a time to build up, a time to weep, a time to laugh, a time to mourn, a time to dance, a time to throw away stones, and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace, and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to seek, and a time to lose, a time to keep, and a time to throw away, a time to tear, and a time to sow, a time to keep silence, a time to speak, a time to love, a time to hate, a time for war, a time for peace. And I would invite you to stand as you're able, in body or in spirit, for the reading of our gospel lesson, which will be a collection of verses from John chapter 14. Jesus said, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to myself, so that where I am, there ye may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going. I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. In a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. I have said these things to you while I am still with you. But the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. As I reflected upon the life of Fred Ray in the past few days, there was a quote that came to my mind from J.R.R. Tolkien in his great work, The Lord of the Rings. And if you are unfamiliar with Lord of the Rings, well, first off, you need to then block off the rest of the afternoon to watch the movies, because they're not Star Wars good, but they're good. But it's a story of the one ring of power and the quest to destroy it. And the ring accidentally, through providence, finds itself in the possession of Frodo, who is a hobbit, a very humble creature. The hobbits just want to live in the Shire and just enjoy the goodness of life there, and they don't desire adventure. But the entire books are based on Frodo now having to fulfill this great burden, this great destiny. And there's this very poignant moment that I always love where Frodo is talking with Gandalf, who is a wizard. And Frodo says this. He says, "I wish the ring had never come to me. I wish none of this had happened." To which Gandalf replies, "So do all who live to see such times. But that is not for them to decide. All we have to decide is what to do with the time given to us." One of the things in life that we cannot control are our circumstances. We have no control to whom we're born. We have no control of where we're born. We have no control of so many of these things. All that we have control over so often is how do we choose to live in the circumstances to which we find ourselves. Many of us know Fred as a towering figure, a man of integrity and of wisdom, of goodness, of kindness, of superior intellect, but whose integrity outpaced even his intellect, which is quite a jump. We know the businessman he was. We know the ingenuity he would have in his business. We know the loyalty and the dedication to his business, yes, but to his family, to his church, to his Savior. We know the man that he was, and the man now through Christ, who he remains. For we know that as believers, as disciples, that this life that we experience here is just a moment, a glimpse of the eternity that awaits for those who are in Christ. And Fred now goes from strength to strength in service to God's eternal kingdom in heaven. So he continues being the man that he has always been. We know him as this. But as I visited with the family and had one of the holier times I've ever had, telling stories and learning, to know from where Fred came, to know the circumstance that he was born into, to know the fact that he said, "I will become something," and then had the willpower, and Martha, to become that to which he aspired. And here to me is what's fascinating about this to me. How many of us know individuals born into challenging circumstances, or individuals who had every opportunity in life that could have justifiably hardened them, making them resistant to grace, making them resistant to knowledge, making them resistant to kindness or to mercy, making them resistant to integrity? Those who have had challenges, who could rightly say, "No, I am going to spend my time protecting myself because that's the only way to make sure I'm taken care of." That, by the way, we all know folks who have encountered these challenges and made that choice. And intellectually, it's a choice that makes sense. You know, if you're an accountant, you get your spreadsheet out and you do some math and you say, "Well, maybe safety is the better option. Maybe hardness of heart is the better option. Maybe rigidity is the better option. Maybe that is the safer option with which to approach the mystery of life." Who could blame someone for choosing that path? And what is amazing to me about Fred is he chose the other path. instead of a path that said the rigidity of this is the way it is. He was a man that says, well, it's never too late to change your mind. Whether that changing your mind was on the person you were dating or the job you had. It was never too late to become something new, to become something different. And that changing of your mind was not a bad thing. That changing of your mind was not something to be pitied or looked down upon, but that changing of your mind was a spark of wisdom and of newness and of life. So many who grow up with such challenges become self-protective worriers. I'm a worrier. You know, clinging. But Fred was a resilient, compassionate, uncritical servant. He was not bound by the challenges of the past, nor did he believe you should be bound by the mistakes of your past. It's never too late to change your mind. He was quick-witted. He was funny. He was optimistic. Better days are always ahead. He worked hard. He knew what poor was. He was humble. We're talking with the family one day about his context. Somebody asked him one time, said, did you ever think you'd get out? And his response was, I was getting out. He was a man with honor and with wisdom. Now, we could attribute that to the fact that he was an Ole Miss rebel, but I know that might be a divisive opinion in the room. He was one of the first, I think, the first Mississippian to be hired by Price Waterhouse, New Orleans. An amazing career. He audited the books of countries and banana plantations in Latin and South America. He literally rode banana boats. He's seen all kind of interesting things like that. He wrote software for the computers for some of the auditing work he was doing. He was the regional governor for the Optimist Club. He's in the Accounting Hall of Fame at Ole Miss and at Holmes. He did so much. And yet he was so humble. He knew so much. There probably were very few rooms Fred was in when he was not the smartest person in the room. Yet he was so humble. He had to him a spirit of uncritical love. He loved his wife so very much. He loved his children, his grandchildren, so very much. He loved his great-grandchildren so very much. He was respectful of people, and he made the world a better place. See, to me, that's the definition of a disciple. Disciples of Christ make the world a better place. A disciple enters into a room, enters into a situation, enters into a context, and that place is better for the presence of that follower of Christ. The followers of Christ make the world a better place. They call us to our better angels. They call us to aspire to goodness. They call us to aspire to faith, hope, and love. They call us to see the world not as it is, but to see the world as it could be, to see the world through the gleaming, radical foolishness of optimism that says there is something better yet to come. And I will do my part to make that better possible. Fred did more than his part to make that better possible. And we have been blessed. We have been blessed for having had the honor and having had the privilege of knowing him, for the family of being loved by him. and for all of us being inspired by him. The Word of God says, precious are the death of his saints in the eyes of the Lord. Today the Lord honors this precious saint of his. I often think of the passage I love so much. The two shortest verses, the shortest verse in the Bible where it says Jesus wept. I love that passage in John's Gospel because it shows us the heart of our Savior, who he came to the tomb of Lazarus, knowing in a matter of moments Lazarus would be raised from the dead. Jesus showed up late on purpose to raise Lazarus. But yet when he got there and saw the heartbreak of his beloved friends, Scripture tells us that Jesus wept. In this moment, as our hearts break, in this moment as we grieve, in this moment as we see the sadness that comes from loss, our Lord weeps with us. Now, that weeping does not invalidate resurrection. Because remember, in a matter of moments, Lazarus was raised from the dead. The tears we cry do not invalidate the reality of the power of resurrection. Because we grieve for us. We're not grieving for Fred today. He's heard, well done, my good and faithful servant. He has entered into the rest prepared for him. He is on the other side waiting for us in God's due time for us to join him there. We don't grieve for him, for he is with the Lord. We grieve for us. We grieve for us. For our lives are diminished. And our world's a little more gray. And that's where we have to cling to the goodness, friends. That's where we have to cling to hope. That's where we cannot let grief change who we are. We cannot let grief change our hope in ourselves and in others. We cannot let grief change our hope in the world. We cannot let grief change our hope in God. Light triumphs over darkness, friends. Faith triumphs over doubt. Joy triumphs over sadness. We grieve, yes. But as Paul tells us in the Word, we do not grieve as those who have no hope. Fred overcame his circumstance and became a beautiful disciple of our Lord. We now find ourselves in the circumstance of grief. And as real as it is, and as painful as it is, we too, through the grace of God, can choose to be affected by grief, to be affected by these things, to have it shape us in some ways. Because yes, we are shaped by these things. But through the grace of our Lord, through the hope of Christ, and through the example that Fred set for us, we know that we also are not defined by our circumstance of grief, but we are defined by the audacity of hope and the goodness of God that flows through all of us and flows through his word. We have hope. Because we have Jesus. We return Fred back to his loving Father today. And we know that one day in God's due time we will join him. Until that time, may we live in the example that has been set for us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Let us pray. Gracious God, thank you for your servant, Fred Ray. Thank you for having shared his life with us. Give us now the purpose and joy that comes through love, that comes through hope, that comes through grace. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. I invite you to stand now as you're able, in body or in spirit, for our hymn of praise, 374, Standing on the Promises.
Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing, standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises that cannot fail, when the howling storms of doubt and fear assail, by the living word of God I shall prevail. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of Christ the Lord, bound to Him eternally by love's strong cord, overcoming daily with the Spirit's sword. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises, I cannot fall. Listening every moment to the Spirit's call. Resting in my Savior as my all in all. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God.
You may be seated. Let us pray. God of us all, your love never ends. When all else fails, you are still God. We pray to you and for one and to one another. For what we pray to you and for one another in this our time of need. Everywhere, O God, we pray for your blessing for all who mourn. For those who doubt, give light. Those who are weak, give your strength. For those who have sinned, O God, give your mercy. For those who sorrow, give your peace. Keep true in us the love with which we hold one another. In all our ways, we trust you. O God, all that you have given us is yours already. As you first gave Fred Gene Ray to us, we now offer Fred back to you. Receive him into the arms of your mercy. Raise him up with all of your people. Receive us also and raise us into new life. Help us to love and serve you in this world. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Fred. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own flock, a lamb of your own fold, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, to the blessed rest of everlasting peace, in the glorious company of the saints of light. We pray this prayer this afternoon, O God, not in our name, but we pray it in the name of the one who taught us to pray as we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Go forth now in hope. Hope even in our grief. Hope that all things are made right in Jesus' time and in Jesus' place. Go forth now living a life of integrity and hope, leaning into the grace of our Savior Jesus Christ. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.